Okay, I know this is a little weird for a TED talk, but I want to come out of the closet. Now, I know what you're thinking. He doesn't know he's gay. No, no, I do. It's not that. Trust, it's been a minute. What I want to come out about today is I want to come out about being a failure. I have disappointed so many people, not the least of which my Jewish mother, by telling you this story. I have lost money. I have messed things up. And what I realized is how incredibly hard it's been for me to be honest about that and to own that. And I thought about why it is, you know? My grandparents were Holocaust survivors. My parents were refugees from communism. And I grew up in Canada. I was born there. And like many first-generation immigrants, I'm sure for many of you as well, there's a tremendous amount of pressure to be successful because of all the things that the previous generations have abrogated to get you there. This kind of cultural framework made failure really, really embarrassing, really shameful. And it pushed a lot of people to do things that were, let's say, a little bit less important, but a lot easier to be successful in. Even the schools that I went to were seriously different from the way that you might imagine them to be. They were extraordinarily academically competitive and challenging. And I remember the teachers, you know, you'd raise your hand to say that something was wrong, and you'd say something wrong, and the teachers would say, if you don't know the answer, don't raise your hand. You're wasting the class's time. Now, I heard. Now, when I say these stories, people gasp. There was an audible gasp in the room, like, oh my God, what? You know, but I feel like we may have swung the pendulum too far the other way. So if my generation, Gen X, was really taught that failure was terrible, Gen X's children are prevented from ever being able to fail at anything. You're not allowed to fall, you're not allowed to scrape your knee, you're not allowed to break a bone, none of that. And I feel like what we need to do is put the pendulum back kind of in the center so that it's okay to fail, it's okay to try things, and it's also okay to fail. Now, this is a thing that I wish I would have known in my first job. I remember going, I worked for Cisco many years ago, and in the orientation, the HR people said, at Cisco, we like to ask for forgiveness and not for permission. I'm sure some of you have heard that. And I thought, wow, this is amazing. These are my people. This is where I belong. This is where my weird ideas can take root. And of course, it was a huge lie, like one of the biggest lies anybody's ever told me, huge. And about a year later, you know, I was done with it, and I was like, I have to move on. Okay, actually, that's not entirely true, since we're coming out about everything. They were gonna fire me. Like, let's be honest, I was gonna get fired. And I was so ashamed and embarrassed of this firing being on my record, of people knowing the Scarlet F, you know, that I went through great pains to describe this as a mutual separation, and I made the company describe it that way too. And so when I took a step back after all these years, you know, I realized that everybody does it, right? I think if you're looking for the greatest number of lies per minute, you'd be hard-pressed to tell if that's on LinkedIn or in a presidential address. There's just a lot of lying. Now, we are not alone in this, you know? There is this concept that's called success washing. I think of it that way. And it's the idea that you go back and you make your past more positive than it actually was. And scientists have a name for this. Behavioral scientists call this self-enhancing transmission bias. And it's basically something, cognitive bias that many people experience. Now, when you're idolizing people in industry, when you're trying to replicate what they do, you realize that the victors get to define history. The victors write the history. And so you have this incredible amount of BS in the bios of really famous, successful people. Like, for example, in Walt Disney's bio, it omits the fact that he bankrupted two animation studios, that he created three of the greatest failures in film of all time financially, almost bankrupting the company, and that Disneyland was such a huge disaster at the beginning that the Disney company pushed him out and he had to mortgage his life insurance policy to get it off the ground. These are not facts that are hidden from the world, they're just not in the official bios. And, you know, I thought that I was pretty good at failure. I over the last 30 years, I've started 6 or 7 companies. A couple of them have been successes, you know, the rest have been more questionable and more failure-oriented. And I thought I had this on lock, right? I had done all the right things. I thought I had this on lock. Until June the 4th of 2018, which was the worst day of my life. So on that day, Apple announced a product called Screen Time that many of you, I'm sure, know. And it's super cool and so good, except it's exactly what my startup was doing. And I had raised $3.5 million for this startup. I had recruited friends and family to come from all over the world to work with me. I was on television all the time talking about what we were doing. But when Apple enters your market, you get Sherlocked, which is the term that we use in the tech business for Apple putting you out of your misery. But I was miserable. I was so messed up. I spent weeks in bed, like unable to move. I was suicidal. I didn't understand why I was so upset. And I would wake up every morning with this voice in my head saying, you're a loser, you're an idiot, you should have done this. And if you've ever experienced that voice, if you've ever heard that voice, psychologists call that the internal critic, the inner critic. And it's actually the voices of the adults in your childhood trying to get you to not mess stuff up. But as an adult, it becomes amplified and just becomes this kind of negative void that is all sort of encompassing. So here I am feeling really bad about everything. And then I start thinking, okay, in the tech business, we're often told these sort of failure axioms, this pablum for failure. Fail up, fail fast and break things. What do those mean? What is fail up? How do you fail up exactly? And what does that mean? And I realized that in tech, the rules of failure have been written by one of three kinds of entrepreneurs, okay? The entrepreneur that had no failure, so their first company was a huge success. The entrepreneur that's amazing at rewriting his or her history, and the sociopath. And I'll let you decide which one of these is which. For those people, for this group of people, failure doesn't mean the same thing. So here I am, feeling terrible about a startup that's failed, and now I'm beating myself up because I feel terrible because I think I should be okay with it. Failure should just be cool. I'm failing up, right? No big deal. So I'm beating myself up after beating myself up. It was really quite major. And I realized that anything that I've done for 30 years, it's been 30 years from my first startup to this point, anything I've done for 30 years, I've gotten better at. But I wasn't getting better at failing. And why is that? And do other people handle this differently? Have other people handled it differently? One of my favorite examples on this research process that I've been on is the Wright brothers. You know that the Wright brothers' first plane that they ever built and flew was a design that they knew was going to crash. It was somebody else's design, the previous design. They got into this plane that they absolutely knew was going to crash. How crazy is that, right? They just knew that they had to crash the plane in order to learn how to not crash the plane. So they had to start there. And at the beginning, the Wright brothers used to invite hundreds of people to watch their plane crashes. They would put up posters and invite people. And then once they started developing a plane that was actually capable of flying, they greatly restricted the number of people who were allowed to see it. Now, this is the exact opposite of the way we normally think about success and failure, right? We bring people into our successes. Look at me, I'm a success. But we try to hide and push people out of our failures. But if we do that, we won't get the necessary feedback to be able to innovate in the way that we had hoped. Or take Netflix. You know, most content networks have a cancellation rate, which is a percentage of shows that are canceled. Most of them try to get that number close to zero. At Netflix, Reed Hastings, the founder and CEO, has said, if the cancellation rate is too low, we're not taking enough risks. And so they manage the cancellation rate up, not down. It's the exact opposite of how you think about it. Or at companies like Pfizer and Tata and Intuit, they actually have failure awards that they give out every year. I'm not kidding you. It's true. The best failures of the year are lauded and awarded and celebrated alongside the biggest successes of the year. People always laugh at this, but it's a thing. And it's really cool because what they realize is that most companies, when somebody fails at something, you get pushed out of the company, either from your own embarrassment or because the company deems you a loser. But if you do that, then the company loses the inherent knowledge of why that failure occurred, and you're back to square zero and you're starting again and again. And so this method helps compensate for that. And the last group of people with an amazing perspective on failure are professional investors. And so venture capitalists and professional angels and such, use a complicated concept from economics called portfolio theory to define how they need to manage risk and reward, okay, to optimize it. Now, it's pretty complicated, and so I have my own kind of more simplified version, which I call pugfolio theory, that we're gonna use to explain this concept today. So when an investor invests in a basket of 10 companies, professional investor, they expect that 6 of those companies are gonna be sleeping dogs. They will never make any money off those companies. They will lose their money. 3 of them will be zombies. They'll continue to exist, but they won't really make anything other than their original investment back. And 1 of them will be a best in show, or what we call a unicorn. And that unicorn is gonna pay for everybody else, you know, everything else that's happened in the portfolio. Now, when lay people, when we, regular people, think about what to do with this, let's say we wanted to increase our return, our first instinct is to reduce the number of sleeping dogs, right? Well, if we could just take 1 of those and move them into the second category, then we'd be better off. But professional investors know that if you focus on the failures, if you try to reduce the failure, you will also lower the return rate for your portfolio, because you'll be de-risking your portfolio and your returns will decline. And therefore, if you're a professional investor, when you put money into 10 companies, you do that knowing full well that 6 of them are not gonna return, and that is okay. You conserve capital to invest in the ones that actually are performing. It's the exact opposite of the way that most of us tend to think about this, and incredibly important, because when we think about our careers, when we're thinking about managing our careers, we often think that the next decision is absolutely the nexus of everything, right? Like anything we do that's messed up is gonna set us way back. But we need to start thinking of our career as a portfolio of things. We need to start thinking of our strategies as portfolios and looking at them across a longer time frame if we really wanna change it. And so as I've been working with and researching and collaborating with all these high performance teams and individuals, I've sort of distilled this down into these 4 points, into this framework for creating additional success and innovation that I call Failosophy. And the 4 basic points of Failosophy are: you have to unlearn your attitude towards failure, so you need to accept it, acknowledge it, unlearn it. You need to model people's failures and not their successes. Stop copying what people did right. You end up with Elizabeth Holmes and Theranos if you do that. You need to copy what people did wrong and learn from that experience. You celebrate, you do not punish people or yourself for innovation that turns into failure. And you need to see your life and your career choices and the investments and the ideas that you have as a portfolio so that you can take a more balanced approach. Now, a lot has been said over the years about the concepts of grit and perseverance in success, right? There's been a lot of research that says that if you have a lot of grit or perseverance, that's the ability to get back up when you've been knocked down, that you're going to be more successful. People with a lot of grit are generally more successful people. But I think this actually misses the point entirely. I think it reflects a kind of structural weakness of our thinking. Because here's the thing, if failure wasn't bad in the first place, we wouldn't need to teach people grit and perseverance. We wouldn't need to like try to bring that out in people, because you would just naturally keep doing it if the failure wasn't a problem. And so what we need to do is structurally rethink our attitudes towards failure for ourselves, in our organizations, in our society, if we actually want to be able to move forward and innovate. And so as a sort of parting thought for you, this is a theme that keeps coming up over and over again in my life, which is when you feel that fear of failure, when you have that moment where you feel like you're going to mess up, what you need to do is lean into it. You need to lean into your fear of failure, because I'll tell you what, feeling that fear of failure means you're doing something actually important. Because if it wasn't important, you wouldn't fear failing. You'd have no feelings. So this is a signal that you're doing something important. And the converse is also true, which is if you are not currently looking into the abyss of a failure in your personal or professional lives right now, at this exact moment in time, then you're not living to your full potential. Life shouldn't be without the fear of failure. And we don't need to be macho and pretend that we shouldn't be afraid of failure. No, I want you to be afraid of failure. I just don't want you to act on that fear by running away from the thing. Acknowledge it, embrace it, and change it. And I think that if we do that, you know, we can really make a difference for all of us. And so for those of you out there who've screwed up, and lost money and disappointed your parents and created a whole bunch of craziness in your life, I want you to know that I see you and we see you. And there's an opportunity for you, starting today, starting right now, to go out into the world and proclaim, I am a failure. I know it's so hard to imagine, but do it. Try it. You're not looking for affirmation. You don't want your friends to say, no, but you're pretty good. You'll bounce back. Just let them hear you say it and let yourself hear that being said. Because if you actually are able to embrace this philosophy, and therefore clear out your closet full of your failures, I think you'll be happier. It's always nice to Marie Kondo your life. But also important, if you clear out that closet, you'll make a lot more room for the trophies and achievements that you're going to earn. And if you embrace failure as a part of learning, you're going to need that space. Thank you.